Today we are going just to refresh some of the things that you have learned before. Sebelum kita go through the conveyancing part of it. Okay, so we will look at the first sale and purchase transaction can be broadly divided into two types, which actually direct sale and sub-sale. So direct sale means you buy the brand new house from the developer or non-developer. So nanti kita tengok who is a developer, why we call them a housing developer, and why we group this the other one is non-housing developer. And when we talk about, and there is another type of sale and purchase which we buy it under the second-hand sale or sub-sale, or they call it secondary market. So yang pertama tadi first-hand market or primary market. Kalau we talk about real estate lah, real estate property, real estate ni. Then the other one we call it secondary market, meaning you buy property yang second-hand one. Okay, bukan saja kereta, barang ada yang second hand. Rumah pun kita ada kategori second hand, which we call it sub sale. Okay, so when we look at the slide, the direct sale, ialah we buy brand new house or brand new property either from housing developer. So when we buy the property from housing developer, the developer, the transaction must use a standard sale and purchase agreement as in the Housing Development Act. So who is a housing developer? Siapa housing developer? Anyone?
Housing developer adalah developer residential yang buat lebih daripada 4 story tingkat. Macam itulah.
4 tu dah betul. Imran ya?
Ya.
Empat unit, more than 4 units of houses, more than 4 units of housing or residential house. So kalau maksudnya dia bina 4 unit rumah, dia bina 4 unit kedai, are they housing developer?
No.
Kalau dia jual 4 unit tanah lot, dia housing developer?
No.
Yes ke no?
No.
No? Yes?
No. No.
No, Megan, no.
Okay, no. So because nanti kita tengok definition dia mestilah build and housing accommodation. Kalau tanah tu, you tak duduk lagi kat atas tanah tu. You baru beli tanah saja. Kalau dia beli jual tanah for the purpose of nak bina rumah, then they covered under the HDA. Okay, so now we know that housing developer is a company or an individual who actually developed more than 4 units of housing accommodation for the purpose of sale. For the purpose of sale. Kalau contohnya, this company built 5 unit rumah, dia bina 5 unit rumah tapi dia tak ada intention nak jual. So, adakah dia kena ambil lesen pemaju? Perlu tak?
Tak perlu sebab tujuan dia bukan untuk sale.
Tujuan dia bukan untuk sale. Kalau you remember kita belajar dulu case energy park tu, yang dia bina bangunan untuk staff punya housing. Yang maknanya company ni dia buat rumah untuk staff housing for the staff punya housing. So dia tak nak jual pada staff dia, dia cuma provide accommodation kepada staff dia. So the units tu masih lagi under syarikat tu. So there is no intention to sell the house to the staff. So they are not bound by the HDA. Okay. So when you develop more than 4 units of housing accommodation and you intend to sell the unit, automatically you are covered under the Housing Development Act, meaning you need to get a license to develop the project. So contohnya kalau macam contohnya pemaju ni, contractor ni, dia bina 3 unit dan dia jual. Dan dia bina lagi 3 unit dan dia jual. So in that situation, they are not bound by the by the act, because dia berfasa tu, fasa, tiap fasa yang dia bina tu tidak melebihi 4 units tu. Okay, so what we want to see later on is the standard SMP ni, standard sale and purchase agreement. Okay, so the first scenario. The second scenario is when you buy a brand new house or brand new property, but they are not from, they are non-housing developer. They are non-housing developer because yang dalam kategori tadilah. Dalam kategori tadi, satu, because this company, they build the not more than four houses or 4 residential building. Contohnya, you beli dengan contractor ni kat kampung, dia bina 3 unit rumah banglo. 3 unit banglo, dan dia offer for sale. So since they are not, the project is not more than 4 units, so pemaju ni, contractor ni, dia tak perlu dapatkan lesen. And they are not bound to use the standard SMP dalam HDA. So they are in the category of non-housing developer. Itu satu. Maknanya rumah dia tidak melebihi 4 unit. So dia tak masuk dalam kategori housing dan dia tak perlu guna standard SMP. They can draft their own sale and purchase contract. Satu lagi juga dalam kategori non-housing developer ni ialah when you buy a property which is not housing accommodation, not for residential use. Contohnya, pemaju ni memang dia bina lebih daripada 5 unit. 5 unit, tapi dia bina kedai. Dia bina kedai, dan you nak beli kedai ni, since this is a shop, commercial unit, this developer is not bound by the Housing Development Act, because Housing Development Act only covers residential property. So dalam situasi ni, when you buy rumah kedai ataupun kilang ataupun tanah lot yang kosong, this developer is not bound to use standard SMP, so they can draft their own agreement. So kita settle dekat the first hand sale. Ada apa-apa soalan?
Tak ada.
Tak ada, okay. So now we are going to move on to the sub sale. Okay, dah habis cerita pasal direct sale tadi. Now, you intend to buy a property which already owned by someone. So this is a second hand house lah kianya. Orang ni dah beli dengan pemaju dulu, duduk rumah tu dalam 5 years. Now they want to sell it to you. So this category of transaction, we call it sub sale transaction. So when they come to the second tier of SMP already, transaction, sub sale transaction, the contract that we are going to use is a normal contract. Bukan lagi standard SMP, walaupun dulu rumah ni dibuat oleh pemaju. So sub sale contract. So they are going to use the standard sale and purchase agreement drafted by the lawyer and agreed by the parties. Okay. So tadi dah bincang, I dah explain this one. Okay. So this one pun dah explain tadi. So kita tengok balik kepada meaning of housing accommodation. Meaning of housing accommodation includes any building, tenement or messuage which is wholly or principally constructed, adopted or intended for human inhabitation or partly for human inhabitation and partly for business premises, and such other type of accommodation as may be prescribed by the minister from time to time to be a housing accommodation pursuant to section 3A. So if we look at this definition, what can you understand from this? Housing accommodation. Ada berapa type housing accommodation dalam definisi ni? Anyone?
Ada tiga.
Ada tiga, madam.
Okay, first one apa?
Human inhabitation.
Human inhabitation. Memang nak duduk, memang manusia yang memang nak duduk kat situ lah, rumah. Okay, satu lagi.
Partly for human inhabitation.
Okay.
And lastly, partly for business premises.
Partly for business premises. What are examples of this category?
Soho, small office, house office.
Small office, home office, betul Imran. Partly for human habitation and partly for business premises. Maksudnya, unit yang kita beli tu, kita boleh duduk dan juga kita boleh buat office. Eh? Because we have to bear in mind, when we talk about developing a housing accommodation or a housing project, the land tu mesti ikut kategori dia. Eh? So kalau rumah untuk perumahan, the zoning of the property tu, tanah tu mestilah dalam zone residential. Eh? Residential. Tanah dia masih lagi dalam kategori building. Eh? Mesti dalam kategori building. Kalau kita belajar land law dulu, kategori of land. Ada berapa? Kategori of land? Anyone? Ingat tak kategori of land?
Agriculture. Industry.
Reserve land.
Yeah.
Building.
Yeah. So ada tiga. Yeah. So agriculture, industry and building. So now we are talking about building ni. Kategori building ni. In this category of building, dia ada dua lagi types or zoning dipanggil. Dalam kategori tanah-tanah yang boleh dibina bangunan, ada dua jenis. Satu dipanggil residential zoning dan satu lagi dipanggil commercial zoning. So kalau you pemaju tu, they want to develop a pure housing accommodation. Projek perumahan yang tak ada bercampur dengan lok kedai dan sebagainya, they have to build the project in this category zoning yang residential ni, residential. But currently there are many developers, dia develop projek yang bercampur dua, integrated development, bawah tu kedai, shop lot, shopping mall, atas tu rumah. So dia nak bina category of this development atas tanah yang mana? Residential ke commercial?
Commercial.
Atau dia rumah. Macam dekat Mesa Mall tu, atas tu apartment, Soho, bawah tu Mesa Mall kat bawah tu. So tanah tu dalam kategori apa rasanya?
Tanah tu under commercial.
Tanah tu under commercial, betul eh? Under commercial. So the land tu must be in, the project tu must be in commercial zone. Commercial zone, so bawah tanah, bawah tu mall tu dalam commercial zone, tapi rumah tu walaupun dia bina di atas commercial zone, because they are residential, Soho tadi, they are bound by the HDA. So kalau dalam this kind of project, mall yang bawah tu dia not governed by HDA. So pemaju kalau dia nak jual lot-lot kedai bawah tu, they are not bound to use standard SMP dalam HDA. Tapi bila dia nak jual je rumah yang atas tu, Soho tu, they must use the standard SMP as in the Housing Development Act. So itu beza dia. So pure house satu, human inhabitation. Satu lagi kategori ni dia hybrid between human habitation and partly for business and partly for human habitation. Okay. Itu contoh dia, Soho, small office, home office or service apartment. Service apartment ni sebabnya dibina di atas land dalam kategori zoning dia ialah commercial, tapi dia adalah rumah. Yeah? So dia dia masih lagi bound by the apa ni? Contract, standard contract dalam HDA. But currently the government is in the midst of amending this provision, this definition, sebab dia nak keluarkan partly for human habitation and partly for business premise ni ke dalam satu akta yang lain. Sebabnya there are a lot of confusion with this kind of project. Sebabnya contohnya you beli rumah Soho, you adalah kategori residential, tapi tanahnya adalah dalam kategori commercial. So you are not entitled to a lot of benefit yang diberi kepada pembeli-pembeli rumah yang biasa. Yeah? Sebab zoning you ialah zoning commercial. Jadi you punya electrical tariff, you punya water tariff, you punya cukai pintu, cukai tanah, semuanya adalah commercial punya rate. Walaupun you dalam kategori rumah. Yeah? So this is the issue lah with this housing accommodation. Fortunately juga, kita di FSU terlibat dalam amendment ni. Kita punya team ada yang terlibat dengan amendment of the HDA ni, dan kita we are doing the drafting of the new act tu. Yeah? Okay, so any question so far untuk ni sampai ke sini? Ada soalan? Tak ada ?
Tak ada lagi dah.
Okay, so tadi kita dah tengok housing accommodation, housing accommodation. Now kita tengok pula kategori non-housing accommodation. Non-housing accommodation ni lebih jelas lah, dia industrial land, commercial office, bungalow lots without building, tanah lot lah maksudnya, agriculture lot, so on ni, dia come under non-housing category. Okay. So, housing developer tadi kita dah tengok, housing development pun dah tengok. Okay, residential, township ni ialah satu, inilah pemajuan yang besar, commercial, and mixed development yang saya mention tadi, mixed development. Kadang-kadang atas ni rumah, kadang-kadang tingkat satu dengan sampai tingkat lima adalah office, tingkat tujuh sampai tingkat belas, Soho, dan tingkat atas ni ialah hotel. Yeah, so this kind of development sekarang ni in trend, di especially in town, big cities, Kuala Lumpur, Penang, Johor, banyak pemaju yang dah buat macam ni. So just to refresh our mind on on types of development and types of property. So kita, we have learned earlier that property ni, masa pemaju tu jual ataupun siapa-siapalah owner of the property tu nak jual, sometime the property dia dah ada individual title dia sendiri. Maknanya setiap unit rumah tu ada geran dia sendiri dah. Ada IC dia sendiri. But sometimes ada juga projek yang mana pemaju belum lagi memohon atau in the process of applying the individual title, so you buy the property still under master title. Maknanya bila you beli unit tu atau rumah tu, you tak ada geran sendiri. You masih berkongsi geran yang besar bersama unit-unit yang lain. So individual title ni, it can be in the form of strata ataupun individual title yang biasa. So strata when you buy the high-rise building. So the types of property and whether your property with title or without title will actually influence or ataupun differentiate the type of sale and purchase agreement yang you akan guna. Okay, so ni pun kita dah belajar dulu. Dalam when we buy property from developer, the direct sale tadi, there are two types of development. Two types of development. The first one is sell and build. Then the other one is build and sell. The developer dalam sell and build ni jual dan bina. Jual dan bina. the developer sell the property first and progressively completed the property within the stipulated time provided under the SDA. So what is the keywords dalam definisi ni?
Sell and build. Sell dulu baru buat.
Okay, sell ambil. Okay, tapi dalam explanation tu apa dia punya keywords?
Pre-order.
Yeah.
Within stipulated of time.
Within stipulated of time lagi?
Sell the property first.
Sell the property first.
Progressively completed.
Progressively completed. So the main keywords dalam ni ialah progressively completed. Meaning to say, in the sell and build transaction, the developer at the point of dia nak develop the property tu, dia jual dulu. Then after that, dah ada buyer for that project. Then dia baru start bina, meaning develop or construct the property progressively within the stipulated time yang provided under the HDA. So dia tak boleh exceed the time. Dan time ni memang dah ada dalam specified in the Housing Development Act. Berapa kalau kalau landed property berapa lama? Dia kena siapkan, pemaju kena siapkan?
2 years.
2 years.
24
bulan, yes. Meaning dia kena siapkan benda tu dalam masa, rumah tu dalam masa 24 months. Kalau strata punya, high-rise building, berapa lama?
48.
Lama sangat tu Imran. Oh,
sorry. Bukan 36 lah madam.
36 bulan 3 years. So untuk strata punya building 3 years So sell and build ialah pemaju jual dan baru bina rumah tu progressively dalam tempoh yang ditetapkan. So at the end of 24 months or 36 months barulah you dapat kunci dan you bayar harga rumah you tu pun progressively mengikut stages of the completion of the property. Okay, so untuk sell and build, standard SMP or statutory SMP dalam HDA ialah Schedule G untuk sale and purchase of land and building. Schedule G, ingat G tu ground, tanah, ini landed property. Kalau untuk yang strata punya, kita guna Schedule H, sale and purchase of land and building or land intended for subdivisions into parcel, high rise building. Okay, so sell and build, satu kategori project yang commonly used by the developer. Developer selalunya akan ambil this, akan engage in this type of project lah. Okay, the other category of project we call it build and sell. Build and sell, the developer develop the property first and sell completed property. Apa keywords dalam definisi ni?
Sell completed property.
Maksudnya, the developer in this kind of build and sell punya project, dia mesti ada satu dana yang banyak. Sebab dia kena, dia at the point of dia nak launching the project tu, dia jual. Dia jual, maknanya you dah beli project ni, you dah bayar 10% masa beli tu, 10% deposit. Lepas tu pemaju akan bina rumah tu sampai siap. Dia tak claim duit daripada you. Dia cuma ambil 10% tadi sebagai confirmation that you want to buy this property. So the developer have to use their own money, build the property, complete the property within 24 or 36 months tadi. And at the end of this period, dia dah complete the property, barulah dia panggil you untuk bayar the 90% balance of the purchase price. Itu beza dia dengan yang sell and build tadi. Sell and build tadi, dia akan minta, the developer will request you to pay the property progressively. Siap 20%, kena bayar 20%. Kalau dah siap sampai 80%, you bayar 80%. So developer is using your money to build the project. Yang kategori kedua ni, developer use their own money, you bayar 10% saja, then they complete the house. So then only you pay the 90% balance. Yeah? So kalau kita tengok category 1 and category 2, which one is safer?
Safer kepada purchaser ke ataupun untuk purchaser, bill and sell
sebab you don't have the risk of property tu tiba-tiba abandon halfway, then you dah bayar certain amount of money, then you will be in trouble lah because the property has been abandoned by the developer, so you have to still serve the bank with the interest and so on. Tapi projek tak siap, rumah tak dapat, bank pun you still kena bayar sebab bank have disbursed part of your loan to the developer. Eh? So build and sell is safer, but this kind of project development very hardly been taken by the developer lah because they need a lot of financial resources to develop that. So untuk build and sell, schedule dia as schedule I untuk landed property and schedule J for strata or subdivided property. So yang ni memang kena ingat G, H, I and J ni because you should not be using a wrong forms and bila prepare documents kepada client. So kena ingat G, H, I and J, kena guna borang yang betul mengikut jenis development yang you sedang buat as a lawyer. Okay, so tadi dah tengok 24 months and 36 months. Okay. In terms of, yang ni saya tak nak tengok dulu, kita akan tengok nanti. Tadilah yang tadi sell and build, maknanya property in progress. Then build and sell, you dah nampak rumah tu berdiri, baru you bayar the 90% balance. Okay, so lastly kita nak tengok macam mana beza build and sell dengan sell and build tadi in terms of payment. So sama juga, at the point of signing of the SMP, you will pay 10%. Dalam sell and build, you bayar 10%. Dalam build and sell pun, you bayar 10%. Okay, dalam sell and build, you will pay progressively the claim tu, the money to the developer within 24 months ni berdasarkan claim dalam SMP tu. So dia ada 10%, 15%, 10% and up to the end tu, sampailah ke hujung tu on the date of the purchaser takes vacant possession and IDT. So sampai ke sini, meaning you have paid around 95% of the purchase price of the property. 95% of the purchase price of the property. Then you dah dapat kunci daripada pemaju. Okay. However, there is still 9%, and the 5% will be retained by the stakeholder and by the lawyer until the defect liability period completed. Until the defect liability period completed. So this is as a protection to the buyer lah. Sebab yang ni baru jugalah dia buat amendment to this schedule of payment. Sebabnya 5% ni akan dipegang oleh lawyer sehinggalah 24 bulan defect liability period to expired, barulah the lawyer will release the whole purchase price to the developer. Ini progressive claim yang you akan tengok dekat belakang schedule 3, third schedule of the SMP. Kalau kita tengok bill and sell pula, borang I and J, sama 10% upon signing of the SMP, then you tunggulah 24 months or 36 months, then after that within 30 days after the receipt by the purchaser of the developer's written notice of delivery of vacant possession supported by the certificate of completion and compliance, then only you bayar the 90% of the purchase price. So itu beza dia di antara sell and build dengan build and sell. Build and sell, bila you dah dapat kunci, dah ada CCC, barulah you pay the balance purchase price of the property. Okay, ada soalan Setakat ini saja untuk an overview of a sale and purchase agreement. Ada apa-apa soalan? Clear?
Madam, kalau kita yang slide awal-awal tadi, kalau kita, rumah tu dia kata dia adalah agent. Kita tak tahu agent tu adalah daripada housing developer ataupun non-housing developer. Sama ada nak guna SNP, statutory SNP ataupun nak guna kontrak. Itu macam mana pula tu?
Macam mana kita beli rumah daripada agent?
Ya. Yeah.
Okay.
Kita tak tahu agent itu daripada developer ataupun yang non-housing, yang non-housing developer. So, okay. Kita tak tahu kita beli itu based on contract ataupun statutory SMP.
Okay, biasanya agent ni dia ada dua lah. Of course, developer pun dia biasa guna agent. Tapi as a purchaser, kalau kita nak beli brand new house, biasanya kita akan pergi ke developers punya office dan tengok sendiri. Maknanya kita tahu itu adalah new project. New project. So once new project, so of course kita akan ada lawyer at that time. Lawyer ni beli from the developer. Biasanya this lawyer appointed by the developer and represented the developer. Tapi kita sebagai purchaser yang kena bayar fees tu. Selalunya macam tu. Sebab macam buy and sell property from developer ni dia agak straightforward. So purchaser boleh pilih untuk appoint their own lawyer ataupun tak nak guna lawyer. Sebab kebanyakan kesnya purchaser tak pakai lawyer lah sebab dia straightforward, dan ada developer solicitor yang buatkan order SMP tu. So as a buyer, you have to enquire lah whether the property tu, of course you will know whether you nak beli rumah first hand ke atau rumah second hand kan. So all those information you need to get inquire from the agent dululah. Okay Imran?
Okay madam. Okay.
Okay, ada soalan lain?
Percentage yang pembayaran ni untuk sell and build memang dia dah bagi dekat dalam akta kan?
Yes, dalam third schedule, dalam progress, dalam schedule of payment tu memang dah ada macam tu.
Okay.
Ya? Jadi Fatihah, ada nak tanya soalan?
Boleh tak ulangkan balik yang...
Buatkan sikit Fatihah suara.
Yang safety purpose untuk sell and build tu. Boleh tak ulang balik?
Sell and build, safety purpose? Maksudnya protection of buyers punya inilah, interest. Okay, yes. That's why untuk housing development ni, they are governed by the specific akta. Sebab rumah ni memang a basic needs of everyone. Semua orang nak beli rumah dan ada their own house. So that's why government intervene dan adakan satu akta khusus. So that's why the developer who sell the property need to use standard SMP. So dalam standard statutory SMP ni memang dah ada inbuilt protection of the buyer's interest. Kalau kita tengok the purpose or the objective of the HDA tu pun ialah to control and monitor the housing development and to protect the buyer's interest. So dalam tu semua ada. Cumanya kalau kita tengok before this lah, because HDA ni dia dah banyak go through amendments after amendments because of the problems occurred in the housing industry ni yang affected buyers punya interest. Memang walaupun ada akta, kita nampak masih ada lagi project abandon, masih ada lagi purchaser yang kena tipu. Because this one is because satunya enforcement, of course lah, the enforcement issue. Satu lagi the flow dalam proses development tu sendiri which allows the developer yang tak nak ambil lesen ni, dia boleh juga buat project tu. Sehinggalah ada orang report dan pihak KPKT kena do the enforcement. Sebab of course kalau projek seluruh Malaysia, KPKT cannot oversee everything. They can only oversee yang mohon lesen. Yang tak mohon lesen, kalau tak dapat, tak ada aduan, tak ada case, they might not know that there are projects which have been developed by the developer without the license. So bila dia tak tak mohon lesen, maksudnya dia mungkin guna SMP yang drafted by their own lawyer dan sebagainya. Dan kalau purchaser tu does not aware about that, mungkin purchaser rasa okay, ada standard SMP dia, dia sign, dia tak tahu sebenarnya pemaju ni dia kena guna the statutory SMP. Tapi the clauses dalam SMP yang ada sekarang dah banyak protect the purchaser's interest. Okay, Fatiha, did I answer your question? Okay, ada soalan lain? Sebenarnya ini adalah cuma a refreshment of your knowledge dalam Housing Development Act lah, yang kita belajar dulu dalam Landlord 2. Okay, kalau tak ada soalan lagi, saya nak proceed kepada slide seterusnya berkenaan dengan sale and purchase from the developer. Saya share slide sekejap. Okay. Okay, so now we are going to look at the sale and purchase from transaction buying from developer. Kita nak tengok kepada details lagi lah. Kalau tadi the overall of the types of SMP and so on. Tapi mungkin kat sini pun ada repetition dia. So now we are talking about buying a brand new house from developer. So this is actually a bulk of cases yang selalunya legal firm akan buat, especially kalau junior lawyers, junior legal assistant, inilah projek yang you akan handle. You akan ada beratus-ratus file projek yang untuk pembelian daripada pemaju. So now we are going to look at what are the things that you need to know when you handle this kind of sale and purchase transaction. So yang tadi kita dah tahu yang kalau you buy from developer, all the transaction, the development is governed by Housing Development Control and Licensing Act 1966 and Housing Development Control and Licensing Regulations. Nama lama dia ialah Housing Developers Act. Okay. So under this HDA, there are four regulations, Housing Development Control and Licensing Regulations, Housing Development Account berkenaan dengan account, Housing Development Tribunal of Home Buyers Claim, because we have specific tribunal for home buyers, Housing Development Compounding of Offences Regulation 2002. So there are four regulations under HDA. Objective of HDA, kita dah belajar dulu, an act to provide for the control and licensing the business of housing accommodation in Peninsular Malaysia, the protection of the interest of purchasers and matters connected therewith. So the application of the act is only in Peninsular Malaysia. Sabah dan Sarawak, dia ada akta dia sendiri. So these are the list of cases yang talk about the objective of HDA. Kalau ni boleh reflect balik dalam ni lah, dalam Landlord 2 dulu kita dah belajar. So I won't go into details about the objective of the HDA. Okay. Now, as a housing developer, when you develop for more than four units of housing accommodation, you have to apply license from Kementerian apa? Kementerian apa yang isu ni?
Ministry of Energy and Natural Resources.
Okay, lagi? Cuba lagi, siapa lagi?
KPKT.
KPKT stand for?
Perumahan.
Ministry of Housing.
KPKT yang issue the license. Dia di bawah bidang kuasa Ministry of Housing and Local Authorities. Kementerian Perumahan dan Kerajaan Tempatan, KPKT. So all the developers who actually built more than four units of a housing accommodation must apply the license from the developer. And not only license, dia kena juga mohon permit iklan dan jualan, advertisement and sale permit. So dia kena mohon lesen pemajuan, dan at the same time dia juga kena mohon permit iklan dan jualan when they want to advertise the project. So when they want to issue brochures, or even when they do not advertise anywhere but they want to sell the property, they need to have this permit. Eh? So sekarang ni KPKT dia issued permit perumahan, lesen perumahan ni dan iklan, permit iklan ni bersekali. Eh? Bersekali. Okay. So a developer is allowed to advertise and make a sale only if it has a valid advertising and sale permit. So dia mestilah ada permit untuk menjual, barulah dia boleh advertise. Eh? Kalau dia dia ratakan tanah, dia terus keluarkan brochures, dia terus offer unit yang dia nak bina tu kepada you, without applying for this advertising and sale permit, it is an offence under the DHD. Eh? And the advertisement tu, because this is for public interest, eh? Dia tak boleh simply letak apa-apa saja yang dia nak letak. Contohnya, rumah ini berdekatan dengan KLIA. Dia kata, ataupun rumah ini ada guaranteed rental 100%. Whatever they want to advertise in the advertisement is regulated. Eh? Under the Regulation 6 ni, dia kena letak perkara-perkara yang telah pun di-describe di dalam regulation ni. Contohnya, the name and address of the developer, the tenure of land and restriction in interest, and dekat advertisement yang kecil tu pun dia kena letak all the details kat bawah tu. Eh, kalau you tengok advertisement projek-projek perumahan ni kecil, dekat bawah tu dia ada semua maklumat ni, tanah leasehold ke freehold, ada restriction interest ke tak, berapa lama projek tu akan siap, all this has to be inserted di dalam the advertisement. And the advertisement shall not contain certain description. Eh? Contohnya, itulah jarak projek ini 5 km daripada Putrajaya. Dia tak boleh letak. Ataupun projek ini 5 minit menaiki kenderaan awam ke Bandar Kajang. They can do that. They can't do that. Eh? Ataupun, apa ni, projek ini ada free legal fees and so on. Dia tak boleh advertise di dalam dalam advertisement permit ni. Boleh tengok regulation 6 on what are the things that they can, they have to advertise and what are the things that they cannot advertise. Eh? Okay. So, sebagai pemaju, dua benda yang you have to do ialah to obtain license and to apply for advertisement and sale permit before you start selling the property. Eh? So in the future, maybe you will bekerja dengan pemaju, pemaju perumahan. So you know that these are the things that you can advise your company lah. Eh? Okay. Now we are looking at the power of minister, because this is a piece of act which actually the objective is to protect the interest of the buyer. So there are powers of minister to safeguard the interest of the purchaser. Eh? So kita boleh tengok power of minister to give direction for the purpose of safeguarding the interest of the purchaser, and the minister may make regulation for the purpose of carrying into effect the provision of the act, the regulation concern on matters stipulated in section 24.2. Eh. So ada kuasa yang diberikan kepada menteri untuk decide what are the types of project that should come under the HTA to safeguard the interest of the purchaser and so on. Yeah? Okay, so while we are talking about that, because there are a few high profile cases that been decided based on this issue. Eh? Kalau you remember, masa kita belajar land housing development dulu, Ang Ming Lee case, Menteri Kesejahteraan Bandar Perumahan dan Kerajaan Tempatan, ini nama lama dia lah. Eh? Masa when we learn the land law tu dulu, this case is at appeal court. Eh? Then they brought the case up to federal court and was decided in 2019. On the issue of power of minister to waive or modify the provisions of the standard SMP. Siapa ingat kes ni berkenaan dengan apa? Anyone? Ang Ming Lee and others. Ada yang ingat?
Okay, ini you have kes to... yang pasal apa ni, controller tu ke? Minister control. Bagi kuasa dekat controller, controller yang akan modify the tarikh, berapa lama projek tu nak siap.
Bagus, good Imran. Betul kan, kes ni berkenaan dengan Ang Ming Lee, extension of time, extension of time applied by the developer. Then what will be the power of minister and controller in this issue? So kalau kita tengok, some of these developer, when dia tak boleh siap the project within 24 months or 36 months, they use the provisions di dalam HTA untuk mohon kepada kementerian untuk extend the time. Meaning varies the terms of the SMP. Kalau the SMP, statutory SMP mention 24 months, they make an application to the ministry to get this provision varies or modify to be extended. So ada power dalam akta tu yang membenarkan the terms to be modified. Tapi this purchaser, when the ministry granted the application to modify the period of completion, the effect to the purchaser ialah walaupun pemaju tu lambat sebab dia dah dapat extension, so they don't need to pay the late ascertained damages, ganti rugi lambat siap kepada pembeli. So this of course will affect the purchaser's interest, sebab projek lambat siap, dia orang tak dapat ganti rugi, so dia orang tak dapat masuk rumah tu, dan they are still, maknanya kalau yang menyewa, dia kena menyewa lagi dan dia dah kena bayar rumah juga. So this affect the interest of the purchaser. So this case they apply to the High Court to get a judicial review of on the decisions of the controller dalam case ni. So lepas tu banyak lagi kes-kes yang lain berkaitan dengan the power minister ni, boleh tengok. Contohnya Alvin Leong Wai Kwan and banyak lagi lah kes-kes yang berkaitan yang susulan daripada decision of court dalam Ang Ming Lee ni. So now we are going to look at Ang Ming Lee punya case. What are the gist of the case? Okay, in this case, the issue is whether the extension of time granted by minister pursuant to regulation 11.3 is valid. So dalam case ni, this a developer, they apply to the minister to get the extension of time amended, modified, because they cannot complete the project within the 36 month. So dia mohon kepada pemaju, kepada kementerian, dan kementerian initially rejected the application. Then the controller reject the application, sebab kalau kat sini you tengok regulation 13 ni, dia kata where the controller is satisfied that owing to special circumstances or hardship or necessity, compliance with any of the provision in the contract is impractical or unnecessary, he may by certificate in writing waive or modify such provision. So permohonan tu dibuat kepada controller, the controller did not approve the application, then this developer appeal to the minister. Sebab dalam provisions akta tu dia ada rights to appeal. So this developer, dia appeal to the minister and the minister approve the appeal, bagi dia extension kepada kalau tak silap 48 bulan instead of 36 month. However, the issue in this case ialah when the approval given by minister tu is granted, but the letter of approval tu was signed by the controller. Surat tu disign oleh controller. Sedangkan appeal tu dibuat kepada minister. So they actually attack on that issue lah. The purchasers punya side ni, the controller has no power to actually sign the letter of approval. So dalam high court, the issue is whether regulation 11.3 is ultra-vires of the HDA and the decision or in the impang letter ni, surat kebenaran untuk approval tu was null and void. So dekat High Court, the court says the regulation is ultra vires. Eh? Then the developer appeal to Court of Appeal. Court of Appeal set aside the High Court's decision and held that Regulation 11.3 is not ultra vires the HDA. However, the Court of Appeal held that the controller could not have made a decision on his own, as it appears in the impact letter, the decision was that of controller. Eh? Kalau tengok dalam kes ni, the letter tu was signed by the controller, not the minister. Eh? So both the buyers and the developer appeal to the federal court. So dua-dua pelah pihak appeal to the apa ni? To the federal court. So kita tengok the decision of the federal court. Okay, the federal court says that the by virtue of section 24.2 tu, yang minister ada power tu. Such responsibility cannot be delegated to the controller despite Regulation 11.3. Eh? The controller has no power to waive or modify any provision in Schedule H. Regulation 3 is ultra vires. The Schedule H is to protect the interests of the buyers. The regulation made by the minister must thus achieve the object of protecting the interests of the buyers. Eh? Because the consequence ni lah, the controller had denied the buyer's right to claim for the LED. Eh? So this case is very important because by virtue of this case, the controller actually has no power to waive or modify any provisions in the statutory SMP. Eh? Statutory SMP meaning, lepas ni kalau ada pemaju yang mohon untuk dapatkan extension of time sebab diorang tak dapat siap projek tu within the stipulated time, they cannot do so by virtue of this case lah. Yeah. Okay, ada soalan? Okay, kalau tak ada saya proceed ya. Eh?
Okay.
Okay. So now we are talking about statutory sale and purchase agreement. As we know, the regulation prescribed mandatory sale and purchase terms to be adopted by the developers. Yeah? The statutory terms cannot be varied by the developer. If there is any variation, such term was which was varied may be declared void. Eh? So tadi, power of minister to vary the SMP. Sekarang ni ialah power whether the developer can vary the terms. Eh? So of course not, eh? Because it is a statutory sale and purchase agreement. So kalau dalam standard SMP schedule HING tu kata 24 months, mesti 24 months. Kalau defect liability period kata pun 24 months, mestilah 24 months. Dia tak boleh simply amend or change the apa ni? The tarikh tu. Even if masa diorang prepare agreement tu, diorang dah tukar siap-siap dan purchaser sign, purchaser sign the SMP with some of the provisions has been amended. When come to court, the court will read the SMP as in the standard SMP. Eh? So kalau SMP sign tu kata completion period dia ialah 48 bulan, standard statutory kata 36 bulan, so the court will read as 36 month. Eh? So kalau yang lebih tu maksudnya dia kena bayar LED dan sebagainya. Okay, we have a new case 2015 about the effect of using wrong form. Eh? So tadi kita kata this kind of SMP kena guna schedule H, yang ni kena guna schedule G, I and G. What is the effect if the lawyer have actually mistakenly use a wrong form? Eh? Instead of guna borang ni, dia terguna borang ni. What will be the effect of the transaction? Eh? So this happened in case Audrey Gertrude de Souza and Sunway Damon Kiara Sendiang Berhad. Eh? In this case, purchaser bought a property which is a bungalow and a courtyard. Eh? Bungalow and a courtyard. Eh? So kalau kita faham bungalow and courtyard, sepatutnya guna schedule apa? Property dalam
G?
Ya?
G ke H?
G grounded.
Bungalow dengan ada courtyard.
G.
G, eh? Sepatutnya bungalow and courtyard is a landed property. So, dia sepatutnya guna schedule G lah. Eh? Tapi in this case, the purchaser ni happen to be, the husband ni dia ialah macam architect lah. Architect or the consultant for the project. Eh? So, the wife bought a unit of the project. But because this developer, dia ada the idea masa tu, masa dia develop project tu macam nak buat macam strata landed lah. Yang masa zaman dia buat project ni belum ada lagi. Eh? So sekarang dah ada strata landed tu. Eh? So the idea ialah they have this bungalow and a courtyard, then dia ada macam common properties lah. Eh? So the developer being advised by the consultant bahawa project ni ialah project yang ada macam strata. So the whole project, for the whole project, they are using borang form H instead of borang G. Eh? So borang H instead of borang G. Then, so the SMP signed between the developer and the purchaser for buying a bungalow with courtyard dalam kes ni ialah borang H instead of borang G. Eh? So what happened after that is that this purchaser dia tak bayar the progress payment and the developer terminate the SMP. Eh? Nanti you all boleh baca lah kes ni, terminate the SMP. So, and forfeited the deposit yang dia dah bayar. So, the purchaser now want to attack, macam want to claim back against the developer by saying that you are using a wrong form. You are using a wrong form because this project it's a landed property, a bungalow with courtyard. You are not supposed to use borang H. You are supposed to use borang G. Eh? So they said this the SMP is null and void because they are using a wrong form. Eh? So the developer, purchasers claim that the developer have to refund all the monies that they have paid. Eh? So they brought the case to the court. Then this is the decision of the court. Eh? Adakah borang H, by using borang H, the SMP becomes null and void and the transactions meaning void from the very beginning lah. Yeah? Okay. In this case, use of form H instead of form G was a contravention as to the form of SPA to be used for the contract between the parties for the purchase of bungalow and courtyard property. Okay? However, the contravention did not go to the substance of the contract. The mandatory language of Regulation 11 of the regulation prescribing Form G and H did not extend to declaring that the contract under any form, other form than Form G or Form H, will render it null and void. So the court decision in this case ialah, yes, you are using wrong form and you have actually committed an offence. You have contravened the provisions dalam regulation. So you have actually committed an offence and you are subject to penalty. But that did not actually go to the extent of nullify the whole contract. Yeah? Nullify the whole contract. Yeah? Because tidak ada dalam regulation tu which mentioned that by using wrong form, it would render it null and void. Instead, section 22 provides that the contract was not voidable because it was used by mistake as to any form of force in law. Ni refer pada contract act. Eh? So the contravention did not render the contract between the parties to be null and void. Eh? So court kata memang ia adalah satu kesalahan sebab you pakai borang yang salah, but it does not render the contract as null and void. And the court further said that a decision to render the contract between the parties null and void because of a contravention of the regulation would not serve the object of protecting the purchaser. Eh? Itu court punya observation. Kalau you declare agreement tu sebagai null and void, dia akan banyak implication. Then in the long run, it actually did not protect the purchaser's interest. So dalam kes ni, walaupun developer menggunakan wrong form, it's still valid. Cuma dia adalah satu kesalahan di bawah regulation. Yeah? Okay. Ada soalan lagi? Ada any question so far? Tak ada, eh? Okay. Okay. This is one interesting case. Baru saja October 7, the decision of High Court berkenaan dengan satu projek di Johor Bahru, the Meridian or Medini in Johor Bahru. This is very interesting. This is newspaper cutting. You can read about the contravention of Schedule H of the HDA juga. Saya tak nak go through ni lah sebab takut tak sempat nak cover yang lain. Okay. So now kita nak tengok types of document yang kita nak prepare when we acting for or we prepare for the purchaser or developer in a sale and purchase transaction direct from the developer. So untuk landed property meaning rumah yang dijual tu dah ada geran, dah ada geran individu sama ada strata ataupun individual title. So documents yang you need to prepare as a lawyer ialah Schedule G dan borang MOT. Sebab dia dah ada grant dia. So the process of transferring the property from the developer to the purchaser must be registered at the land office and the instrument that we are going to use is the memorandum of transfer. So clear. Sama ada lihat strata ke atau landed ke, dia dah ada grant individu. Dokumen yang you kena ada dalam file yang perlu signed by the purchaser and the developer ialah Schedule G, meaning the standard SMP dan juga borang MOT. Okay, untuk property without title, now you are handling a project. Pemaju ni dia jual property yang belum ada geran individu. Belum ada geran individu. So, what are the documents that the purchaser and the developer need to sign? Untuk landed property, rumah atas tanah, contohnya rumah teres, so borang dokumen yang perlu ditandatangani cuma satu saja, Schedule G tu. Standard SMP tu sahaja. We don't prepare the MOT because the property is still yet been issued with the individual title. Untuk strata property, strata, high-rise building, Schedule H, dan ada satu lagi dokumen tambahan yang dipanggil Deed of Mutual Covenant. Kalau Schedule G tadi dia tak ada, Schedule H dia ada Deed of Mutual Covenant. What is Deed of Mutual Covenant? Nanti kita akan tengok dalam slide seterusnya lah. So this is the illustration of what I mentioned just now. Maknanya kalau rumah, dia ada geran dia sendiri, MOT dengan Schedule G. Kalau landed property beli rumah apartment, dia dah ada geran strata dia. So, you kena prepare MOT dan Schedule H. Okay. Kalau untuk yang tak ada geran individu lagi, property without title, kalau dia rumah teres, kita guna rumah yang landed, you prepare Schedule G sahaja. Dan kalau dia rumah yang berstrata, dia belum ada strata title, so kita prepare Schedule H and Deed of Mutual Covenant. Deed of Mutual Covenant. So ni we are talking about build and sell lah. Sell and build. Build and sell tu kita tak cerita lah. Schedule I, J tu sebab it's quite seldom kita buat benda tu. So tadi untuk property without title, Schedule H and Deed of Mutual Covenant. Kenapa yang ni ada, yang ni tak ada? Kenapa yang ni ada? Why it is necessary to have Deed of Mutual Covenant. So what is actually Deed of Mutual Covenant? Deed of Mutual Covenant ialah an agreement between the developer and purchaser to obtain certain terms and conditions deemed necessary for the maintenance of the development. It defines the agreed rules that regulate all use and maintenance of shared areas in the strata property. So as we know, kalau untuk high-rise building ni, kita ada parcel dan kita ada common properties. Jadi Deed of Mutual Covenant ni, actually it lay down the rules and regulation with regards to the use of the common property, to the rules and regulation to maintain the harmonious living in a strata. Because you kongsi banyak benda dengan banyak orang dalam strata living. Compared to yang ni, ini rumah you, you tak kongsi apa-apa dengan jiran sebelah you, you kongsi pagar je lah kot. So they don't need this Deed of Mutual Covenant. Tapi dalam strata punya living ni, because you nanti kongsi lift, kongsi tangga, So all these has to be specified dalam deed of mutual covenant. Ya, contohnya tak boleh sidai baju dekat apa ni? Dekat koridor. Tak boleh bela binatang. Tak boleh itulah macam-macam yang do's and don'ts tu dia akan letak dalam deed of mutual covenant. So every purchasers need to sign orang schedule H dengan this deed of mutual covenant. So they agreed with the terms and condition of the strata living. Eh? Okay, so kalau sekarang ni, because we have the Strata Management Act, all these bylaws pertaining to the shared unit ni dah ada dalam third schedule of strata management, maintenance and management regulation 2015. So dalam strata, third schedule ni dia pun ada list down peraturan-peraturan. Contohnya boleh tak boleh buat apa, boleh buat apa, semua tu ada dalam third schedule. So the issue is ni satu artikel baru juga lagi Februari lah tahun ni, is the deed of mutual covenant still relevant? Because kalau zaman dulu sebelum adanya strata management, memang developer has to specify all the do's and don'ts dalam deed of mutual covenant. But apa ni? Nowadays, because dah ada strata management act, they are actually provided in the third schedule. So you can read this article to see what is the position of the deed of mutual covenant after the enactment of the strata management act. Boleh bacalah artikel ni. Okay, yang ni statutory termination of the sale and purchase agreement. Yang ni pun kita dah belajar dulu, saya tak nak go details sebab takut tak sempat, pun dah 11.20. Okay. So far okay? Boleh? Boleh ke? Ke dah overload sangat? Boleh pergi lagi? Apa, kita break 5 minit boleh? Saya pun dah kering tekak.
Okey, doktor.
Ha, okey, kita break 5 minit.
Okay, dah boleh mula ke? Ke ada yang ke toilet ke apa? Sampai 5 minit lagi lah. You order breakfast belum? Sempat tak breakfast?
Sempat.
Sempat. Eh? Sambil-sambil dengar, duduk dengan lecture pun boleh makan juga kan? Okay, kita ada dalam beberapa slide lagi insyaAllah. Nak habiskan. Oh, sebelum tu saya nak download attendance dulu. Okay, so now saya sambung ya. Apa ni, we are going to look at the slide adik tadi. Okay, so now we are talking about the procedures lah, about the procedures when you have been appointed as the solicitors for the developer. Normally in a housing project, developer will appoint their solicitors to handle all the sale and purchase transaction. Yeah? So their panel solicitors. So, contohnya pemaju ni, dia develop satu township, ada lebih kurang 500 unit buah rumah. So they will appoint a few lawyers to do the sale and purchase for them for that particular project. Yeah? So this solicitor appointed by the developer, normally we do the sale and purchase transaction and we do all the necessaries until the property is transferred to the name of the purchaser. Yeah? However, this solicitor ni is actually acting for the developer, not the purchaser. Yeah? So kalau kita nak, contohnya you nak beli rumah daripada pemaju, so bila you jumpa lawyer tu is the developer solicitor. Eh? So you may appoint your own solicitor kalau you rasa macam property, you nak better advice from your own lawyer. Tapi commonly practice sebenarnya kalau kita beli rumah daripada pemaju, because dia adalah straightforward transaction, jaranglah orang ambil lawyer. Eh? Kita akan rely on these developers, lawyer saja yang buat dokumen. Okay. So under Legal Profession Act, Section 84, the requires the solicitor acting for the developer to obtain statutory declaration from the unrepresented party to effect that she does not require legal representation. Yeah. So biasanya, tapi sebenarnya yang statutory declaration ni kalau zaman saya practice dulu pun tak pernah lah diguna pakai. Tak pernah pun kita bagi purchaser to sign this legal representative declaration, statutory declaration. Tapi this is provided under Section 84. Bila mana kalau pembeli ni tak represented, tak engage any lawyer, dia kena sign satu declaration yang dia tak require legal representation. Eh? So kalau kita tengok dalam Section 84 ni, mention that where an advocate and solicitor acts for a housing developer in a sale of immovable property developed under a housing development, neither he or any member or assistant of the firm shall in the same transaction act for the purchaser. So dia tak boleh, dia acting for purchaser, dia juga acting for the developer. Dia tak boleh jadi common solicitor. Eh? Of the property, and a written agreement prepared by the advocate and solicitor, okay, provided that if any such written agreement in respect of the transaction is not scrutinized by an advocate and solicitor acting for the purchaser, the advocate and solicitor or acting for the housing developer shall obtain a certificate signed by the purchaser that the purchaser does not intend to engage an advocate and solicitor to scrutinize the agreement for him. Yeah? So, kalaulah purchaser tu dia tak engage any lawyer, so the lawyer ni acting for the housing developer need to obtain a certificate, huh, that the purchaser does not intend to engage a lawyer. Then this certificate has to be signed in the presence of commissioner for oath, meaning it is a statutory declaration. Ini adalah requirement di bawah section 84. Nanti bila jumpa dengan Puan Hafizah, boleh juga tanya dia mengenai the practice lah, adakah ini selalunya diamalkan di legal firm. Okay, now this is a situation where purchaser does not intend to engage a lawyer for the purchase of the property from the developer. Tapi the purchaser may actually appoint their own lawyer. The purchaser solicitor, so when the purchaser intend to engage a lawyer, so the purchaser solicitor may write to developer for four sets of agreement free of charge. So sekarang ni purchaser ni dia nak ambil lawyer dia sendiri. So lawyer dia boleh menulis kepada lawyer pemaju dan minta four sets of the agreement tu free of charge. Dia tak boleh kenakan apa-apa bayaran. Upon receiving the agreement, the solicitor must conduct a land search against the titles. So tadi satu situasi hanya developer yang ada lawyer, purchaser tak ada lawyer. And second situation, dua-dua pihak ada lawyer dia sendiri. Okay, saya boleh terus pergi ke yang gambar ni. Okay, ini ialah senario di mana kita beli property from developer. So kalau kita tengok kat sini, when you have actually surveyed the project, you dah dengan satu-satu unit. So you go to the purchaser, to the developer's office, book your unit and you pay upon signing of the SMP, 10% of the deposit. So nanti kita akan bincang juga berkenaan dengan isu booking fee. Selalunya, bila you pergi ke pejabat pemaju ni, you rasa you nak, you berkenaan unit nombor 10 ni contohnya. So pemaju selalunya akan minta you letakkan booking fee untuk unit tu. Booking fee untuk unit tu contohnya you kena bayar RM1,000 dulu. RM1,000 dulu. So what is the position of this booking fee? Nanti kita akan tengok. So by right, kalau kita tengok statutory SMP tadi, the first payment yang purchaser kena bayar 10% deposit ni upon signing, bukan upon booking tu. Upon signing of the SMP. Okay. So deposit 10% upon signing of the agreement. So of course you need another 90% untuk finance the purchase of the property. So you akan ada your bank, purchasers and financier bank. So bank ni yang akan actually finance the balance of the 90% of the purchase price. Okay, so developer ni when they want to develop this project, they might need certain financial assistance juga. So the developer might make a loan from a bank. So the bank that developer obtain the loan, we call bridging financer. Kita kata belajar itu kan, bridging financer. Okay. Di sebelah, kalau saya lah kiri lah, sebelah kiri ni ialah situasi whereby the purchaser is not represented. Yang kolom hijau ni. So you dah booking, you dah bayar 10%, you dah pergi sign SMP, so the purchaser does not intend to engage any lawyer. So the next task will be done by the developer solicitor. So DS ni, developer solicitor prepare schedule G, get purchaser and the developer to sign. Then the developer solicitor stamp the agreement, give a copy of the agreement to the purchaser and developer. So at the same time, since this purchaser actually have obtained a loan from bank, so this developer solicitor need to issue a letter of undertaking to this bank solicitor to mention that they are going to forward the MOT to the bank solicitor for the bank to actually present the MOT and charge together at the end of the process. Ini satu situasi yang pertama whereby the purchaser have no lawyer. Okay, the right side ialah process flow when the purchaser appoint their own solicitor. Purchaser ni tadi dia nak ada lawyer dia sendiri, so the appoint their own solicitor. So this solicitor, the first task ni ialah to write to the developer to get the copy of the SMP. So dia yang akan scrutinize the provisions dalam SMP tu. At the same time, dia akan conduct land search. So this solicitor will arrange for the purchaser to sign and send back the document for the developers to sign. Then this purchaser will stamp the agreement and give copy to the respective parties. Yeah. At the same time, this purchaser solicitor juga yang akan issue letter of undertaking to the bank solicitor. So this is the simplified process of it lah. Okay, ada soalan kat sini?
Saya kurang jelas yang bank solicitor advice for drawdown tu.
Okay, so bila because the end process ni ialah dekat bank solicitor, bank solicitor sebab bank solicitor dia akan present memorandum of transfer dan document of charge dia sekaligus. So bila developer solicitor atau purchaser solicitor ni dah complete the process of signing the MOT, kalau case yang ada title lah, sign the MOT, dah stamp the MOT, dah bayar, maknanya dalam tangan solicitor ni dia dah ada stamp memorandum of transfer. This document together with the original title tu dia akan forward kepada bank solicitor. So bank solicitor sekarang ni in their hand they should have the original title, the duly stamped MOT which they will get it from the developer solicitor ataupun purchaser solicitor. Then dia punya part dia akan prepare charge in favor of the purchasers and financer tu. Nak gadaikan property ni kepada bank yang bagi loan 90% tadi. So once this document dah ada dalam tangan bank solicitor ni, bank solicitor dia akan present, daftarkan all these documents simultaneously. So at the end dia dah daftarkan borang pindah milik, dia dah daftarkan borang gadaian. So at this stage barulah bank solicitor ni dia selamat untuk dia advise bank untuk release the loan progressively. Itu maksud bank solicitor advice for drawdown tu. Maksudnya at this stage dia dah boleh advise the bank. Okay, dia akan kata kat bank, nanti bila kita belajar loan kita akan tengok lah macam mana advice letter tu ya. Dia akan kata kat bank, okay sekarang ni bank orang pindah milik dah daftar, maknanya property ni dah pun dipindah milik kepada purchaser. Apa tu? Borang gadaian pun dah daftar. So dah maknanya gadaian kepada bank pun dah selamat. So now it is safe for you to release the loan progressively to the pemaju. So ini adalah simplified process dia. Nanti kita kalau ada kesempatan kita, dan mungkin juga nanti you akan go into detail dengan Puan Hafizah lah dalam tutorial. Okay, boleh Syami?
Kiranya ini okey, ini adalah untuk situasi kalau kita beli rumah daripada developer. So what I say, in the event kalau kita beli rumah daripada non-housing developer, kat sinilah juga proses di mana yang kalau ada redemption apa tu?
Redemption sum.
Yes, kat sini juga ke?
Ya, betul. Okey, dalam situasi ni juga dia boleh jadi redemption, ada redemption sum . Contohnya pemaju ni dulu dia ada buat pinjaman dengan bank bridging financer ni. So biasanya untuk setiap unit ni dia tidak boleh melebihi 50% daripada purchase price dia, redemption sum dia. So kalau rumah ni masih lagi tanah ni masih lagi tergadai kepada pihak bank bridging financer, progressive loan tu pertamanya akan dikeluarkan kepada bridging financer dulu. Bridging financer dulu. Dan apa ni, barulah balance duit tu akan diberi kepada pemaju. So dia ada banyak senario lah. Nanti senarionya property yang free for encumbrances, property yang ada encumbrances dan lain-lain situation tu . So detail prosesnya dia akan beza sikit kalau property tu ada redemption, property yang tak ada redemption. Okay, Amin? Okay, mungkin nanti bila ada tu kita tengok daripada segi flowchart dia yang lebih detail lah. Sebab ini adalah just nak gambarkan the overall scenario macam mana all the process tu interrelated to each others . Okay, so ada sikit lagi slide saya. Okay, tadi sampai sini, preparing schedule G and H. Eh. So biasanya inilah dokumen yang paling banyak you all akan buat lah kalau you act for the developer. Preparing schedule G and H, maksudnya macam mana nak isi standard SMP yang dalam statutory dalam HDA tu, schedule G, H, I and J tu lah. Eh. So kalau dekat depan ni, kalau you tengok dekat depan ni, the first page of schedule G and H ni ialah all the particulars about the purchaser, vendor, particulars of the property. The developer solicitor has to fill in the particulars required in the blanks in asterisk mark A to P. Eh. So kalau you tengok dekat depan tu nanti, dia ada tanda asterisk. Eh. Asterisk yang mengatakan kolom ni kena diisi in the preamble of the schedule G or H. So you boleh notice ada A sampai P, dia punya asterisk tu. Maksudnya particulars yang we need to fill up ya, dalam maklumat ni. Eh. So kalau kita acting for purchase for the developer, maklumat-maklumat ni kita akan dapat dan biasanya kerani kita lah yang akan isi semua maklumat dalam ni. Dia standard saja, once you ada satu template then you just can print out. Cuma nama purchaser saja you akan ubah. Eh. Okay. Proprietor to be a party to the contract. So kita, as we have learned earlier, sometimes dalam satu-satu projek, there are developer and purchaser and sometimes dia ada tiga pihak, proprietor, developer dan purchaser. Yeah. So, in this standard SMP, proprietor will be a party to the transaction as well. Eh. Walaupun biasanya proprietor ni, dia akan bagi power of attorney to developer to deal with the property and the whole project. Yeah. Sebab proprietor ni sometimes dia macam dormant party sajalah, dia tuan tanah. Dia tak tahu apa-apa pun pasal pemajuan tu. Dia tahu dia ada tanah, at the end of the day nanti dia akan dapat beberapa unit rumah ataupun certain sum of money. Tapi in the SMP, mesti ada particulars of the proprietor tu. Eh. So kalau when you do the sale and purchase agreement, you akan check. Oh, kalau ada transaksi ni ada proprietor, ada tuan tanah, yang berbeza dengan pemaju, the details of the tuan tanah tu mesti diletakkan. Eh. Contohnya tuan tanah tu ialah individu. Eh. Contohnya tanah tu milik Atan bin Abu. Pemaju Sunrise Development, purchaser Ahmad. So, an agreement between Atan bin Abu as the proprietor and Sunrise Development as the developer and purchaser. So, maklumat tu mesti ada dekat depan ni. Eh. Okay, how many copies that we need to prepare the agreement? Schedule G, H, Schedule G, H, I and J tu adalah 4 copy. Satu original, kita akan chop sebagai original. Satu duplicate copy, yang dua lagi kita akan chop sebagai copy. Eh. So original ni will be given to the purchaser, original dengan duplicate. Kopi satu untuk file lawyer, satu lagi ialah untuk developer. So 4 copies will be given. Okay, purchaser akan dapat 2, original dengan duplicate. The original copy ni will be given to the bank and financial bank tadi, sebab all the original documents pertaining to the transaction selagi loan tu belum settle adalah dalam simpanan bank. Eh? So purchaser tu nanti cuma akan ada duplicate copy sajalah dengan dia. Kecuali dia adalah cash buyer, then of course dia tak ada isu pinjaman dengan bank, then they can keep the original and duplicate. Eh? Okay. So if you look at the standard SMP, kat belakang tu dia ada a copy of the approved layout plan, a copy of the approved building plans, a copy of the building description and third schedule of payment. So ini adalah dokumen yang have to be annexed kat belakang SMP tu. So dokumen-dokumen ni biasanya you akan dapat daripada lawyer, daripada developer lah. Eh. Third schedule ni ialah schedule of payments, memang standard dalam SMP. Yeah. Okay, so now you have prepared the document. Sekarang you have met an appointment to the purchaser that you call the purchaser to sign, to come and sign the agreement dekat office you. Eh? So you dah buat appointment dengan purchaser untuk datang tanda tangan dokumen. So these are some of the important clauses that you need to explain to the purchaser. Eh? So you just imagine kalau you sebagai pembeli, pembeli rumah baru. So of course you need to know what are the things that going to happen within the 24 months or 36 months. What are the protection that is granted to you? So as a lawyer, you kena tahu nak explain all these clauses. Contohnya kalau purchaser tanya, kalau tiba-tiba saya sign agreement ni, saya tak dapat loan, macam mana deposit saya ya? So macam mana you nak jawab tu eh? So all this sebenarnya ada dalam agreement tu. Financial facility ni, what is going to happen if the purchaser have paid the 10% deposit, then dia pergi cari, dia pergi apa ni, approach bank, semua bank kata dia tak layak nak mohon pinjaman because mungkin dia ada bad reputation or bad record dengan bank sebelum ni. So dia dah bayar 10% deposit, what is going to happen? So semua tu ada dalam ni. Okay. Ini purchaser's right to initiate and maintain action, late payment charges. Contohnya, kalaulah you dah complete the transaction dan semua dah advance bank, bank lambat release progressive claim. Contohnya, developer have claim up to the stage of 40%. Sebab claim ni mesti dibayar by the bank within 30 days, kalau tak silap saya, within 30 days of the notice. So kalau tiba-tiba bank lambat bayar, you will incur interest. So who will bear the interest? Bukan salah purchaser, bukan salah lawyer, tapi bank delay in the release of the loan. So who will bear the cost lah for the late payment tu? Default by the purchaser and determination of the agreement, position, measurement, boundaries and area of building lot. Okay, situasinya ialah contohnya tiba-tiba you dapati rumah yang you beli tu kecil sikit daripada yang sepatutnya. Contohnya dia kata bilik tu sepatutnya 20x15. Tiba-tiba you ni very particular, you pergi ukur. Kau tengok 20x13 je. So what are the protection to you as a purchaser? Dia ada dalam position, measurement, boundaries and area of building lot. Okay, material and workmanship conform to the description. Contohnya kalau dalam agreement tu kata dia akan pakai tiles yang sekian kualiti ataupun tiles berukuran 5 inci. Tiba-tiba bila property siap tengok tiles tu 3 inci saja. So what the purchaser can do in this situation? Time of delivery of vacant possession, ini paling banyak isu. Property kena siap dalam masa 24 bulan atau 36 bulan tapi kunci dapat setahun selepas itu. So what will be the remedy to the purchaser? Okay, manner for delivery of vacant possession. Okay, kalau agreement kata property mesti siap dan water and electricity connected. Connected. Adakah maksudnya bila you pergi ambil kunci, pergi ke rumah yang baru beli tu, bila on api dah nyala atau bila buka air dah keluar air atau apa maksud dia properly connected tu? Defect liability period, dalam tempoh berapa lama you boleh claim defect liability period? Contoh dah ambil kunci hari ni, tengok pergi duduk rumah tu 2 bulan, tengok sinki jatuh ataupun tiles tiba-tiba terbuka. So what are the remedies available to the purchaser? All are explain di dalam clauses in the SMP. So as a lawyer, you have to know how to explain all this to the purchaser. Sebab sometimes you ada client yang datang, kat mana saya nak sign? Just sign je. Tanpa request for an explanation. Tapi as a lawyer, you still need to explain jugalah. Tapi ada purchaser yang betul-betul nak tahu dan dia request for you to explain clauses by clauses. So you have to master and know what are the things that you need to explain to the client. Then these are some of the important clauses that you need to know. Okay. Stamping of the SMP cuma RM10 saja. To be stamped RM for RM10. So kita ada 4 kopi tadi. So RM40. So the method boleh je guna adhesive revenue stamp from stamp duty office. Kita boleh beli stamp hasil tu RM10. Ataupun kita hantar dekat kaunter yang dia akan letak franking merah tu dekat atas dokumen. ataupun sekarang dah ada e-stamping. E-stamping ni kita hantar melalui online apa ni? Online application, dan nanti dia akan keluarkan satu sijil sijil stamping which in accordance with the value of the stamp duty. So nanti ini pun mungkin nanti you akan dapat lebih banyak info lah lepas hopefully daripada practitioner because e-stamping ni pun satu benda yang agak nak kata agak baru, tapi masa zaman saya praktis dulu tak ada lagi lah e-stamping ni. Okay. Sikit lagi, aduh nak habis masa dah. Okay, redemption statement yang ni solicitors undertaking. Purchaser solicitors undertaking yang tadi saya kata undertaking to the bank financer. Undertaking ni ialah to deliver a duly executed, adjudicated and stamp MOT. Maksudnya, purchaser ataupun developer solicitor ni mesti undertake untuk menghantar the duly executed and stamp MOT kepada bank solicitor bagi membolehkan bank solicitor to present and present the documents at the land office and then advise bank to release the loan. Kalau pending this document, bank tak boleh nak keluarkan duit tu. Okay, so this is normally the content of the undertaking. Dan last kali ialah what is redemption statement. So redemption statement, jadi kalau bank developer tu dia ada pinjam dengan bridging financer. So redemption statement is a statement issued by the developer's financer, which is the bridging financer, setting out the sum payable to redeem the bridging loan for the purchaser's lot. In return for the payment of the redemption sum, the purchaser receive a letter from the bridging financer disclaiming all rights to the purchaser's lot. The payment of the redemption sum to developer's financer at the same time also constitute payment by the purchaser toward his purchase price. Once the bridging financer issue a letter of disclaimer, their rights over the purchase lot, any foreclosure proceeding will not affect the purchase lot. So ini situasi di mana tanah tu masih lagi tergadai kepada bank. So to get the bridging financer release the property, we have to pay the redemption sum. So nanti bank tu dia akan keluarkan satu statement berapa redemption sum untuk setiap unit. Nanti kalau sempat mungkin di lain masa kita boleh tengok macam mana how it calculate or goes on with the redemption statement tu. Okay, last kali solicitor's fee. Okay, you are entitled to charge the client according to the scale fees bila you buat all this documentation. Cumanya untuk housing development, because we are using the statutory document, but you bukan, the lawyer does not actually draft the SMP. We are adopting the statutory agreement from the HTA. Jadi of course lawyer dia tak boleh charge full scale fee. So dia kena bagi kata macam statutory discount lah kepada purchaser. So these are the rate for the legal fees kalau you buat document SMP for the purchase of property from developer. Saya letak je kat sini dulu, nanti mungkin detailnya kita akan belajar further dalam tajuk fees, stamp duty and so on. Okay, saya rasa itu sahaja untuk hari ini. Tajuk SMP, itulah banyak jugalah hari ni yang compress into one lecture sebab kita pun tak, memang setiap minggu tu ada topik yang khusus yang memang tak boleh nak skip lah rasanya. Okay, so ada soalan? Ada 4 minit lagi. Dah overload ke?
Okay. Soalan.
Tak ada?
Medium. Saya ada persoalan berkenaan dengan stamping document. Apa yang dimaksudkan dengan stamp duty ad valorem tu?
Okay, stamp duty ad valorem ialah stamp duty yang according to the scale. Sebab kalau stamp duty ni dia ada dia ada yang nominal fee, macam RM10 ni ialah nominal fee, ya. Tapi dia juga ada stamp duty ad valorem bergantung kepada nilai tanah tu. So dalam kalau contoh transaksi ni, kita stamp agreement tu nominal fee RM10, empat salinan. Tapi stamp duty ke atas MOT nanti, memorandum of transfer tu, ialah bergantung kepada nilai property yang you beli. So that, this is the ad valorem. Contohnya kalau you beli rumah tu harga RM100,000, so stamp duty dia akan mengikut nilai RM100,000 tu. Dia first 100,000 kalau tak silap ialah 1%. Jadi kalau property you RM100,000, stamp duty yang akan dibayar ke atas dokumen pindah milik ialah RM1,000. Itu ad valorem stamp duty. Okay, boleh Syamil?
Kiranya ad valorem apa tu? Stamp duty ad valorem ni adalah satu lagi tambahan lah eh. Kiranya kita ada RM10 tu. Lepas tu yang kalau untuk MOT kita ikut yang scale tu macam tu.
Yes. Sebab kita dua-dua dokumen ni kena stamp. Agreement tu kena stamp tapi dia nominal. Tapi yang MOT ni kita stamp mengikut ad valorem, mengikut nilai value property ataupun transaksi tu.
Okay, faham dia.
Okay, ada soalan lain? Okay, tak apa. Boleh simpan soalan tu dengan untuk sesi tutorial nanti. Okay, kalau tak ada apa-apa soalan, alhamdulillah we have covered the topic of sale and purchase from housing developer. So next topic akan ada on sale and purchase from non-housing developer dan juga untuk convincing techniques lah untuk minggu depan insyaAllah kalau tak ada aran. So that's all for today. Thank you very much. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi ta'ala wabarakatuh.
Thank you, madam.
Thank you, madam.
Thank you, madam.